Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Equal Opportunities Committee. It's the 17th meeting of 2015. Can I ask you to set any electronic devices to flight mode or switch off, please? Apologies have been received from Sandra White. I'd like to start with introductions. We're supported at the table by the clerking and research staff, official reporters and broadcasting services, and around the room by the security office, and also welcome to the observers in the public gallery. My name's Margaret McCulloch, and I'm the committee's convener. And members will now introduce themselves in turn, starting here on my right.
Good morning, convener. Drew Smith, member for Glasgow.
John Mason, MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Morning, Annabel Gould, the MSP for the West of Scotland.
Good morning, John Finney, MSP Highlands and Islands.
Good morning, Christian Allard, MSP for the North East.
Thank you. The first agenda item today is a decision on taking business in private. You're asked to agree consideration of a draft report on your inquiry into age and social isolation at item 3 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Agenda item 2 is an evidence session on our inquiry into removing barriers, race, ethnicity, I can never say this word, excuse me, ethnicity and employment. If witnesses or members wish to speak during the discussion, please indicate to either me or my clerk on my left-hand side. We are restricted for time today, so can I ask you please to keep your answers focused as much as possible? And I welcome the panel this morning. I can ask witnesses to introduce themselves, and can I also invite witnesses to briefly outline the work of your organisation and any current projects for the members here, please. Thanks. And we'll start with, is it Naira?
Naira.
There you go.
Hello, my name's Naira Dar. I'm the Race Equality Mainstreaming Officer for CEMVO Scotland. CEMVO Scotland is a national intermediate organisation and a strategic partner of the Scottish Government. We deliver a wide range of programmes to ethnic minority voluntary sector, including areas such as leadership, graduate internships, social enterprise and financial inclusion. We've also been working in the last 3 years on a race equality mainstreaming programme, working with the public sector, voluntary sector, the statutory sector to look at how they implement race equality within their organisations. That again has raised a number of issues that probably we'll have further discussion with here today.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jatin Haria. I'm the director of the Coalition for Racial Equality and Rights. We're a strategic anti-racist social policy charity funded by Glasgow City Council to do local race equality work in Glasgow, funded by the Joseph Rowntree Charitable Trust to do parliamentary activities across Scotland, and we're currently funded by the Scottish Government to work with them and other partners on developing the new race equality framework for Scotland.
Hi, I'm Suzanne Munday. I'm Chief Exec of MECOPP, which is a minority ethnic health and social care organisation. We are also a strategic partner of the Scottish Government, and one of our projects working with Gypsy Traveller communities has strategic intervention status.
Thank you.
Okay, and I'm Rami Ousta, the Chief Executive of BMC Scotland, which is the umbrella national organisation for the ethnic minorities, third sector, and the community this sector represent. We are a strategic partner to the Scottish Government, and we work across Scotland within a membership of organisation base. Our main work covers three main overarching objectives, which is capacity building and empowering active citizenship for the diverse communities, policy and influencing policy through research and proactive intelligence and consultation gathering, and to promote education for democratic citizenship and human rights education setting. And that's in very briefly.
So, thank you very much. We'll start the questions off now. And John Mason.
Thanks, convener. And the area I'd like to start with is to do with, you know, how it's important that we differentiate amongst different ethnic minorities, because I think there has been some suggestion that if we just use the generic term ethnic minorities as a kind of homogenous group, that that is not helpful. And I just wonder if you could maybe comment on that, and perhaps also comment on any particular groups that you feel we should focus on or that tend to get missed out. I mean, I was interested in Bemis, in your submission, and it talks about understanding and service provision to identify ethnic minority communities as being solely identified solely upon visual identification and lazy jargon unrepresentative of census data. So that was quite strong, but I thought it was quite good. So maybe you could expand a wee bit on that.
There's always been discussion, and we spent enough time with stakeholders arguing whether the context of identifying minorities as black and ethnic minority, black and minority, ethnic minority. Now there's a new term called the black, Asian, and ethnic minority. It's our belief that the Equality Act 2010 does not give hierarchy to any ethnicity. The division between identifying visible and invisible minority has caused lots of problems for certain communities who remain below the radar, and when data are quoted, usually quoted in certain settings that reflect the visible minorities. For example, I read some comments to say the ethnic minorities in Scotland have increased from 2 to 4%. Actually, if you identify visible and invisible minority, it adds up to 8.2%. And this is an area that we are always keen to see stakeholders and policymakers acknowledging. It's not about acknowledging in documents and going back to when you produce documents to refer only to visible minorities. It's not fair because some groups are disappearing under the radar when we're talking about this. The issue, for example, when you talk about the Polish community data, the Irish community data, seems to be sidelined when official documents or official things coming from the government. This is an area of concern for us. For us, we acknowledge ethnic and cultural minorities, but when you talk about the census of the data, when you talk about classification, which says white, non-white, okay, that is a serious term for us. Doesn't help you to identify within the subgroup setting of who are the group meant to this. So our concern is when ethnic minority is used as a classification rather than a description. And this is an area that we see it again and again in policy making. This is leading us to show as if ethnic minority continue to be there, it's them, and the rest of the population, it's like us here. So this is an area we invite the committee to acknowledge, please, that ethnic minority is not about color coding, it's about identity, about culture, and about diversity, even within the minorities themselves.
Okay. Thank you. Picking up on that point and reiterating what Rami said, I think in using a term that homogenizes communities, and by doing that actually detracts from individual experience both within and out with communities, is not helpful. And we would argue that different population groups within minority communities actually have very different experiences. So, for example, the position of women within minority ethnic communities, young people, disabled people, carers within the workforce, for example, they will all have an experience which is unique to them. And to adopt a sort of a unilateral one-size-fits-all approach does not take cognizance of different experience and different barriers.
Just to be devil's advocate for a minute, I mean, the fact if you've got 8% when it is a whole group, even though that 8% is all different, I mean, 8% is a serious amount, so yes. I suppose it does give a bit more clout, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It could, yeah.
There are differences between different ethnic groups, obviously, but it's a silly argument, and I hope we don't waste too much time today talking about it. When the employment rate in local authorities in Scotland is less than 1% on average for all minority groups, it's silly arguing whether that affects Pakistanis more than Bangladeshis or something like that. I think when we get to a stage where we can have those discussions, when the numbers are much higher, absolutely need to have those discussions, but not now. At the moment, the problem is generic across all minority ethnicities. But also, let's not use this to diminish the issue of colour discrimination, which is what some people want to do. Colour discrimination is still a main problem in Scotland. And also, in terms of white ethnicities, there's a generational issue here. I will always be black, my kids will always be black, their kids will always be black. If you're Polish and you assimilate in two or three generations, nobody will know you're actually of Polish origin if you choose to hide it. So, you know, if you look at MSPs, how many MSPs are of Irish origin? I have no idea, but I bet there are a whole number of you who are of Irish origin. But we know who the black MSPs are, and they will always be there.
As well, but I mean, if some groups, and we did get impression from some of the Spice briefing that, you know, some groups were more disadvantaged than others, even within an Asian context, that people from some backgrounds were doing better than others. Do you feel that's not an issue we should be looking at? Or it's not important.
I don't think it's the main issue in if we're talking about employment, because the figures are so low across all minority ethnicities.
Right.
But obviously, if there's a particular problem, then we need to address that. But I don't think an employer says, I'm not going to employ you because you're Bangladeshi, but I'll employ the Pakistani guy.
Right.
I don't think that happens, really.
Right, OK. Right, thanks.
Yeah, I think I just wanted to make the point that when we use the term ethnic minorities, we put everybody under one umbrella. And what we don't recognise within that is the differences between second and third generation minority ethnic groups that have been here long established and those that are new members of the community. And the issues for those that are in second and third generation facing employment are not the same for those that are coming into the country in the last few years. So we don't have the same barriers in terms of language, in terms of education. But if you look at the statistics, there is still that barrier in terms of access to employment. So I think some of the things that we want to kind of discuss in detail today is why we have young ethnic minorities, and I will say Pakistani because it's the largest ethnic minority group in the young category, that are represented highly in our higher education establishments but are not seen within our unemployment workforce. And I think that's an absolute tragedy because you have the potential for Scotland of losing all that talent and leaving when we have an ageing population.
If I can carry on, that was helpful, thank you. In your own quote, I think from CEMVO, that right, I saw one point that was interesting to me, the lack of consistency in relation to collection and publication of data means that in Scotland at present the level of non-disclosure varies hugely. For example, across all 22 health boards, a small number have achieved excellent results in recent years, but with apparently little attempt from others to learn from the good practice or to level up, which I thought was quite good and quite strong. I mean, what should public bodies be doing? What can they be doing more than they are at the moment? Because there seems to be a whole issue around self-reporting and people not reporting what their ethnic background is.
I think what we find is that people are applying for posts and at that stage they are disclosing their ethnicity to some extent. But what we're finding is that there is not enough data to find out who is actually being employed. So in my mind, this is not a new concept. We've been expected to collect data. Public sector organisations and the NHS have been expected to collect ethnicity data and others for a number of years. So what is the hidden agenda that they're not wanting to disclose exactly what number of their workforce is actually from a BME population? And I find that quite concerning that the HR departments are not wanting to do or be proactive in this manner and yet claiming that they're actually following the guidelines of the Equalities Act.
Being more proactive than others?
In some respect, yes, because we know now that figures are dropping, but we're also finding that people are refusing to disclose because they don't see the nature or the understanding of why you're having to record that information. And also there is a suspicion now that that's going to be used against them. So in that respect, I think it's become very blurred because there has not been a consistency, there has not been a clear direction or leadership in terms of what do we do in recording employment and our workforce in relation to race and ethnicity. I think Jatin mentioned earlier we've got local authorities in some places less than 1%. They must know what that means. They have known what that means. There needs to be a bit more enforcement of actually expecting and requiring local authorities in the NHS to be more proactive in actually understanding and doing something about their data. The collecting of the data in itself is not enough.
Thank you.
Jatin, or is it Suzanne first? Yeah.
Thank you. I think that there are nuances. Like, it's been my understanding that the data capture around ethnicity and other equality indicators is more advanced within new recruitment, but there are particular issues around the established workforce, and we see a lot of problems with data collection where, you know, you have your existing workforce. So I think that's one issue. I think that there is a failure to learn from existing good practice because there are public bodies which have much higher rates of data collection than a lot of others. So I think there's an issue about sharing good practice and learning about how they've actually approached this issue. I also think that there's a quite a high degree of complacency amongst public bodies with regard to data collection. So, for example, we have had reflected back to us, well, you know, the number of our BME employers actually, in terms of a percentage size, reflects the percentage size of the population within the census. And if that is good enough, it's clearly not good enough, because public bodies are actually meant to work towards exceeding that baseline of representation. So I think complacency is an issue also.
Travel to work areas, it probably we shouldn't be matching where people live and where people work, because a lot of people do cross boundaries, don't they? Yes.
And people, you know, increasingly, because I think of pressures within the employment market, people are increasingly travelling longer and longer distances to work. So the fact that your workforce has 1% doesn't actually tell you the catchment area from which that 1% is gathered also.
Mm-hmm. Jatin, do you want to come?
Yeah, I was just going to say, if some people can get it, can do better at monitoring, why can't everybody? It's not an endemic problem, because some people have done it. But I think we quote Lothian Health Board has only got 50% knowledge of its staff. Yeah. But other health boards have got 80, 90%. So, you know, what is the problem there?
Asking?
Absolutely. They're nervous about asking. They actually don't ask, probably. It's back to the leadership mm-hmm. thing. And in the health context, where you really need to know patients' ethnicities to provide a real good service, mm-hmm. if the staff can't disclose their own, how are they going to ask a patient? You know, so there's lots of issues there, but there are solutions. I mean, you know, there's a move towards sort of self-reporting on a computer system, so nobody actually has to see what you put on the form. I'm not sure that's the best thing, but it's there if you want to use it. I would be in favour of doing a headcount, and you know, managers identifying if that's what it takes to initially get a baseline, because we need that baseline.
I'm okay, but I think it's more.
Just to go back to the whole question of the public bodies and the reporting of ethnicity and data, there is a general agreement among us that public bodies are failing in keeping records or reporting on their public sector equality duty settings in relation to data. However, there are issues in that regard goes beyond the negligence, and all this is more of, we came across a Syrian public body recently who was required to keep ethnicity data, and some of the suggestions from them that there are some minorities refusing to give their data, so they are authorizing their staff to guess the data and write it down. And that was a serious concern for us, still ongoing, by the way. And the only alternative for them is to revert back to, say, black and white. And this is one sample of a national major public body in Scotland. As Jatin mentioned earlier, leadership, advice, and we feel some of public bodies get intimidated when external bodies like us and I try to advise them or interfere in this setting. So we believe that the EHRC could play a more role. They've been playing a positive role and should be directed to have more monitoring role on public bodies in this context.
What would your advice be to that organisation? Because they obviously feel they're stuck. They can't force people to tell them their background, so they're making guesses. But what would you suggest to them?
But at the same time, they are required to report on this data recording. The main issue is just to see how they can understand the census data, the way the census recorded the data, for example. If people are not willing to disclose their ethnicity, okay, they don't want to disclose this ethnicity. It's not like there is something they have to, or to put a bullying tag, you have to disclose it. By doing this, we came across some youth, for example, in some of the programs on employment we're doing. They are ethnic minority youths. They don't see themselves as ethnic minority. They see themselves as Scottish citizens. There's no point in forcing those people to pigeonhole them in certain ethnicities. The same with the wider setting. So this is an area that can operate within cooperation, within training onto public bodies, but not to sit and guess what ethnicity. Actually, I asked the senior person to guess my ethnicity, and it took him 10 good minutes, and he couldn't. So, but I couldn't understand how senior people take this decision to allocate, I'm not going to state that the public body, sorry, that they can guess and write it down. This is a complete deformation of the purpose of gathering this data, reflecting on their policy, on strategy, on what's required by the whole Scottish government and society. So this is an area we have to pay attention to.
Well, I think I've used my time,
Would it help if at the stage of sending out letters for people to come for interview, at the interview stage and also at the induction stage, if this information was explained clearly to people, the reason why the data is very important, do you think this would help?
I think definitely. definitely, yeah. Because people, even minority people, will be hesitant to disclose this for fear of discrimination, fear of racism, fear of other settings that's relevant to them. But that's a good idea. Yeah. In terms of employment, it's a different story where you can get disclosing your ethnicity without having to know who you are and all this. So this is almost employers and the sector, definitely third sector, deploy that setting.
Yeah, because it did come up when we were having the discussion with people at Skills Development Scotland and for the modern apprenticeship, and their numbers is very small, but I actually meant to ask, that probably doesn't capture people like the Polish groups as well, which work in a lot of the industries where there are modern apprentices in the hotel sector, the tourism as well. So that's really interesting, thank you. We can take you very, very briefly, but it's have to be very quickly. Okay. Suzanne and then Naira.
Going back to data collection, I think there's also an issue about public bodies not using the information that they are collecting, and sometimes it's almost data collection for collection's sake. So I think there is an issue about potentially more guidance being needed by public bodies to use the information that they collect. And picking up on the point about encouraging people to disclose, whether it's ethnicity, sexuality, etc., again, our experience has been that, you know, very often, you know, the employer will give information, but it will be one-off. It won't be sustained. Very often there's a churn through the workforce. So it's something that needs to be repeated in terms of reassuring people about why the information is needed, how it will be stored, how it will be used. And that has to be ongoing.
Naira, briefly.
Just briefly, the example that Rami gave in terms of asking the questions, I think there's a huge training requirement in terms of giving staff confidence to ask those questions and an understanding of why they're asking them. And I think that confidence is not there because the leadership around equality is not there. And if the senior directors don't understand why they're doing it or how to do it, then how do you expect frontline staff to do it?
That's a really good point. Thank you very much for that. We'll move now on to Christian.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. And it's the same kind of lines, and you answered a lot already. I just want to go a bit further, maybe. You just talked about the confidence for people to ask the questions. And BMIS, for example, and the key recommendation ask that the Scottish Government should take that kind of leadership to decide, you know, what should be the questions to make sure the people who ask them has got confidence to have them. So that's very part of that inquiry that we are making. Unfortunately, we seem to get a lot of conflicting answers of how we should go about it. You talked about, and we heard that before, about making sure we don't go in pigeonholes and putting people in pigeonholes. Unfortunately, you know, if you want to have the question, if you want to have data, do we have to do that, or do we need? And you know, I've got one of the written submission from CEMVO regarding the example in Northern Ireland, where the Equality Commission guide has encouraged the principal method of direct questions. I don't know if it's another method we could think about, and what you talked about, Suzanne, is seeing the individual and making sure that maybe that will help give confidence to the people who ask the question, asking direct questions, and maybe seeing more the person. Is that a way we could maybe answer the problem that we seem to have of pigeonholing people? Yeah.
2 points in this context. I agree with you with regarding the pigeonholing and all this. First of all, when we ask for data collection, it has a purpose. We're not doing it just to identify people or to classify people in terms of their ethnicity. And when we do this, or when stakeholders do this, we are enabling what we call is evidence-based policy, to develop evidence-based. Rather than, if we don't do this, we will end up with policy-based evidence. Okay? The same with evidence-based strategy or strategy-based evidence. So this is the risk where public bodies are running by ignoring to take evidence based on ethnicities. But within BMIS perspective, especially if you understand that we have the young generations in Scotland from the minorities differ dramatically from the older generation. And the way we operate with this group is we have to identify the whole concept of active citizenship within the minorities, where we as ethnic minorities, we live in Scotland as citizens. We don't live in Scotland because we're ethnic minorities. So we enable or empower the young people to function in that capacity. However, nothing is taking away their ethnicity. They should be proud of it, should be able to sustain it. But this is not when barriers become because of their ethnicity, to enable them to come around the table as full citizens, that's when we can operate. But the aim is not to keep on all their lives, just classifying them based on their ethnicity. It's them, black and this, black and this. If people feel they are ready to move to forward within the citizenship setting, that's what we should have structures in place to enable them. And I must take one more extra minute, sorry. Having worked in Europe for the last 8 years as BEAM's organization on active citizenship, equality, we come back to Scotland to compare the policies, the setting, what we have. We say we are well advanced from Europe. Some groups don't like to hear this, and that's their opinion. But the fact is, we are ready. I'm not saying everything is great, wow, brilliant Scotland. What we're saying is Scotland has achieved a lot and has prepared us as minorities to develop and function as citizens. So we should take this step by improving this setting rather than sitting there just asking for our rights. That brings me back to the whole concept of a human rights education. Our role is to empower the minorities to understand their rights, but to understand their responsibilities and to act on these rights. It's not just this is my right and sit on it. That's when it comes to employment setting. If we come across, for example, certain public bodies are discriminating, is to teach those individuals how to stand up to this, how to build their own skills to challenge this setting. So what I mean by pigeonholing is when with the census, the whole thing, they have to go under black. It's ridiculous for young generations who feel proud of being Scottish. Even our modern apprenticeship program, people acknowledge their ethnicity, but they said, what do you mean? We're not ethnic, we're Scottish. So we should develop this, enhance this, rather than drag them back to the classification setting. Description of ethnicity is something, and a classification is something else. It's a dangerous thing.
What was the question to you? And should we go to a different way, maybe like Northern Ireland does, asking direct questions and letting people say individual answer the way they want to answer it?
In this context, it's actually not about what the individual feels or who they are. It's about looking at whether there's discrimination in the recruitment process. And that's why we want that data to show whether there's an imbalance in the figures. And if there's an imbalance, then you look into why that imbalance is there. Sometimes there may be good reason. Sometimes there may not be any. You can then prove discrimination. So I think we need to twist this around. So at one level, I'll disagree with Rami here. I'm happy with a black-white definition at this stage. When the figures are less than 1% for public sector employment, it's no point arguing whether Bangladeshis are a bit more discriminated than Pakistanis or the other way around. Not at this point. There's general discrimination against all people of color, and that's what we need to address first. And then maybe in 5-10 years, we can look at whether there's individual semantics within all that.
I just have a problem with this. When we decide something, it's for the future. It's not for the present. So, you know, it will maybe create a problem for 5 or 10 years in 5 or 10 years' time. So, you know, there's an issue there in our inquiry. We're really trying to see, you know, what we're going to do and making sure that what we recommend is fit for the future. So is there a balance there?
So I'm not sure what your question is, but one more point. Because we need the data and we need to compare it to something, that's why we have to use the census categories at the moment, because there's no point knowing how many... one-legged people there are in the workforce if we don't have a baseline to compare that to, you know. So the census figures are adequate for now, the census classifications.
I would say that the census is always going to be a bit of a crude tool, absolutely. But in the absence of anything else, it does serve the purpose of establishing a baseline from which we can begin to measure progress, you know, whether it's forward or backward. The other point I would like to make is that ethnicity appears to be something that we ascribe to minority communities, forgetting actually that we all have an ethnicity, and that is a point I wanted just to make.
I think the point that I wanted to make is that, yes, we do have these classifications, and maybe they're not the best, but in order for us to do comparable data comparisons, we have what we have at the moment. But I also think we need to be clear what we mean by ethnicity, and it's, you can have an ethnicity, but how you feel in terms of your identity is two different things. And I think your identity is what you'd you assign to yourself, and your ethnicity is what you're assigned to, if you like. So I think it's just worthwhile making that comparison. I think the example you gave, and it's true, the young people today don't see themselves as a minority ethnic or whatever category we assign to them in terms of data collection, but they do see themselves as young and Scottish, but that's their identity and maybe not their ethnicity.
Okay. And that comes to my other question. It's getting more and more complicated because of that, of new generation. So I think that if there is another inquiry in this parliament in 10 years' time, we'll find it a lot more difficult to answer these questions. But regarding, going back on that, you know, age, gender, social class, and all this kind of thing, do you think we should have two sets of questioning, you know, the normal ones which we'll find out, and another set of questions to try to enlarge a little bit the net and getting more information of what the workforce is and what the real issues are.
Coming to this and reflect on the previous setting as well. In terms of promoting identity, I mean, the ethnicity will never be a barrier to promoting that setting, enabling. But if we want to sustain it within the ethnicity, there will be a barrier to enable those groups, especially young generations, to progress their identity. The worry for us is it is important to use data. It is ethnicity data in terms of employment and other settings. But the worry for us is if we identify any gap in terms of public bodies or services setting within the ethnicity, if we want always to call for an exclusive setting for those minorities, that is a risky thing. That is not acceptable for us as minorities. The idea is to use these gaps to promote what we call an inclusive setting for everybody, rather than call for exclusivity based on ethnicity. This is something very, very dangerous. And the worry for us is when we use these gaps, when we identify an ethnicity in terms of employment, is we always seem to be viewing that within the discrimination and racism. Again, that's not acceptable for us. We should move beyond the setting of everything is interpreted in terms of discrimination, racism, to question ourselves as third sector, as minorities, as policymakers, what are the issues? Like, if there is a gap, we know there is a gap. The research will tell there is a gap. And the reason behind this gap, what are we going to do about it? What has been done about it? That's why I came across some of the presentation given here is things haven't changed for the last 40 years because we're not taking a proactive role to explore and investigate the reason for this gap, for example, beyond saying there's discrimination and racism and all. This something has to move on. I mean, there is discrimination, there is racism, nobody's denying it, but not at the scale that would make us focus all our efforts in that context. It's more about creating equal opportunities, creating partnership, advice, and support. Again, there is, if I can quote this example as a last thing, there's a serious stakeholder public body approached us for advice on how to consult with certain groups to form their policies. And they were amazed that we were prepared to do this free of charge. And they were saying that another group asked them for £5,000 just to facilitate a workshop for them. That is not acceptable from a public body, a public money-funded organization to serve the whole of Scottish scene, not to serve only ethnic minorities. That's when we say about BEMIS is we are an umbrella organization for the sector, but to fit within the Scottish scene, not to fit as ethnic minorities. And I asked a question for one of our great ministers to say why we're getting funded. I said, to help ethnic minorities. To do what? I mean, just to eat and sleep and go and cluster and settle, or to be active citizens as part of Scotland. And that is the thing that we should all aspire to. I don't doubt everybody is, but the mechanisms differ. But please do not identify every gap we identify in terms of data for employer within discrimination and racism. We should be having more discussion about how do we tackle this in different settings. Sorry.
Response. Thank you very much for that. Anybody else want to reply? No. Are you finished, Christian? Yeah. We'll now move on to Annabel.
Thank you very much, convener. I want to cover the possible barriers to employment, and my first question is about young people. Is there a need for more resources and attention to be directed at young people who are either seeking or participating in education, training and youth employment initiatives to try and prevent or reduce unequal labour outcomes such as low pay and occupational segregation and maybe later on barriers to promotion?
In a very short response, yes. our organisation, CEMVO Scotland, has worked with BEMIS and Inclusive Scotland to develop a graduate internship to do exactly that. It was a short-funded piece, as they usually are, but we got positive results as at the end of that programme because we were able to positively put them in new routes to employment through different forums. So I think there is a need to invest because we're having to face the inequalities that these young people face when they're going into the job market. That needs to be addressed somehow, not just within organisations like the public sector, the statutory sector and the private sector, but also there needs to be additional support because, as my colleagues refer to, if we need to have a community that's constantly thinking, how do I challenge this? How do I have a responsibility to challenge discrimination. I have a responsibility to come forward. I have a responsibility. Why do we have all the responsibilities? There are generations of young people growing up in Scotland that never even need to think about this. My children will have to think about this. My children will go to university and graduate and then think, oh, what now? I don't want that for their future. I want them to be able to compete equally with everybody else that they graduate with. So, yes, we do need, at the moment, that additional resource and support for people to combat the inequalities that they're facing. Thank you.
Suzanne. I think that one of the gaps that we face is in terms of positive action for BME young people as one of the ways of supporting them into the employment market. As far as I'm aware, the housing model delivered by PATH is very successful. But one of the gaps that we have identified is the lack of data in terms of longer-term impact. And one of the actual calls we would make is for the committee to consider some sort of longitudinal survey, because we know that people are going into PATH provision. 5 years down the line, where are they? 10 years down the line, where are they? Are they reaching middle and senior management posts? Are they having a wider impact on the recruitment, retention, promotion practices and policies of those organisations that they are employed in? But equally, why aren't we looking at that model and whether it's transferable in other sectors to, again, enable BME young people to examine and explore possible career paths? Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I would argue we should look at, well, the issue should be issue-led rather than resource-led. We need to identify what the problems are and then allocate resources rather than just find money, which is what governments often do. They throw some money at what they think is a problem without actually recognising what the problem is, and certainly no longitudinal measures to see if it's successful. But that's the nature of short-term funding for things. Not necessarily a youth issue, but the data we've got, and the latest data from public sector bodies that they published in April, still shows that people are applying in relatively large numbers. Black people are applying in relatively large numbers for public sector jobs. They're getting interviewed, so they're meeting the qualification and the experience levels required, but they're falling at interview. You know, we've got data from Aberdeen, 13.7% black minority ethnic people applying for posts, only 6.8%. Black minority ethnic people getting appointed. So you're half as likely to get appointed if you're black than if you're white in Aberdeen City Council. That we need to examine why that is, and then we can address the problem. It may be discrimination. I'm not saying it is, but it may well be. I think the figures are that stark. I'm sure there's some discrimination in there somewhere, but there may be other reasons. But until we know what the reasons are, we can't do anything about them.
Just to go back in terms of the intervention setting, I agree with Jatin that any intervention should be an issue-based rather than resources-based. But I'm afraid you will be upset, all of you, with me now sending me out in a minute, because I'm usually more blunt with my answers to face realities even within us as ethnic minority or third sector organization. So it's not always the fault of the others, and we have to explore and investigate our own intervention and setting of supporting the equality setting. After all, we're working within a race equality dynamic and process, not within racism and discrimination. going to the young people setting, I mean, like, for example, everybody knows that ethnic minority youth are underrepresented in the modern apprenticeship setting, and everybody's aware of it. I was speaking at a conference where a colleague from a similar setting stood up to say to SDS, oh, there is underrepresentation of ethnic minority, that's because you're racist. And that is ridiculous. When I challenged this behavior and said, we just throw this sentence and let them worry about it, that's not the way to be responsible and to take things forward. I give you an example. The modern apprenticeship partnership BEAM is developed with Skills Development Scotland. Already, the outcome of that, the structure we're putting in place, is amazing, even for SDS and for us and for the wider scene in Scotland. Another program we're doing, which is the called Gather Together, which is addressing underrepresentation of parents in their participation in their children's education, reflecting on their attainment, the school structure. The impact of that, we can see it in positive settings, like even schools, even parents, even parent council, beginning to see how come this happened. Although when we did a mapping exercise with parent council about participation of ethnic minorities, some of the answers we were getting, for example, they would say to us, we can't get white people, never mind them. Why should we pay for their interpreting? And you think, wow, instead of saying, oh, they're racist, no, we work with them to invest in training program, involve them. And now I think the number of increase of participation of parents in the setting is amazing, even to our own expectation. So this is an area of intervention when I say by being proactive, by linking to the stakeholders rather than intimidating them and pushing them for a quick gain through funding bits or just to bully them. This is something that the sector should be signing. All the sector are doing positive things, but again, there are local minority groups misusing resources. We are aware of a couple of organizations supporting employment where they will print the same CV from the internet for the next 50, 60 ethnic minorities. That is abhorrent. That is not accountability for public money. We should be brave to stand up and say where the gaps within our proactive role or reactive role. And it's not only just, but we need the government and their policies to support the setting. So we have to be blunt in this. And I apologize if you see me taking both sides, but this is for Scotland. This is not for ethnic minority or for anybody else.
Thank you, Annabelle.
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions. The public bodies that gave evidence to the committee on 3rd September referred to unconscious bias as one explanation for inequalities in the labour market. So very briefly, can I ask each of you, what do you understand by that term, unconscious bias?
I'm sorry, but that's just a new term for saying, I actually do not accept that term at all. You cannot say that you're unaware that you have discriminatory practices. In this 2015, we've had plenty of legislation to inform public bodies what their duties are. They've had plenty of time to write their own reports in terms of their own actions, and to use a term such as unconscious bias to me is a get-out clause. I think it's about hiding institutional discrimination.
I'll be more blunt. As you say in our submission, it's racism until you get caught, and then it suddenly becomes unconscious bias.
I would agree and also say that the focus shouldn't just be on public sector employers, but also private sector employers as well.
I think from our perspective, I mean, there's no doubt unconscious bias is another terminology to saying that, for example, people don't fit in certain culture, organizational culture, or stakeholders resistant to culture, organizational cultural change. So they blame it on unconscious bias. But that doesn't mean it doesn't happen in terms of understanding cultural variations between certain employers and ethnic minority setting. But for us as well, it's not acceptable. It reflects a strong resistance to organizational cultural change.
Annabelle?
I was going to ask, but given what the witnesses have been saying, the answer to this may be anticipated. I was going to ask, are you aware of any steps currently being taken to address unconscious bias, both in recruitment practice and the day-to-day activity of workplaces, and what further steps you think are needed?
I mean, the problem there is, so this new term has cropped up in the last few years, unconscious bias, so people are now spending lots of money training their staff instead of doing what really needs to be done, addressing the real issue about race and employment. So sending more staff on more training is not going to change the situation. It's just another way of not passing the buck, but avoiding doing something real.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? No? I think that's the
That's quite depressing.
I think we've been, if I can come in here, it's becoming more of a framework for some people to initiate businesses. Like we get various groups who want to train on unconscious bias and all this. So I agree with the group that there should be more control in how this is handled or is even talked about. The issue is not about providing training to the staff and all this. It's well, well beyond that.
Okay.
I just think there's a role here for the regulatory bodies to have a clear understanding of how they look at equalities when they regulate, you know, public sector organisations. And I think a term like that wouldn't exist if we actually had a clear understanding of what equalities and race equality and leadership means within an organisation. I've had people in the past, in my own experience, say things like, oh, it was an inexperienced manager. So we no longer have inexperienced managers, we now have unconscious bias. So there's always going to be a terminology that will come together that will try and dilute or negate the experiences of discrimination or institutional discrimination, and I think this is just one of them. I think you do need to have training to a degree, but I think the type of training needs to be appropriate. Too much focus has been on training staff on the legislation, but not actually telling them what they need to do to make a difference, and I think that's a key issue that needs to be addressed. And I think partly organisations find it easier to tell them what the legislation is, because they don't really have an understanding themselves of what they need to do, or maybe that willingness is not there because it's too much of a cultural change for them.
Very briefly and finally, and again, I think your answers have maybe pointed a way forward here, but in your written submissions, both CRERE and CEMVO point to the need to do more to tackle institutional discrimination. So I wonder if I could ask Naira and Jatin what steps are needed to do this, particularly where employers may not recognise that their organisations and workplaces are discriminatory.
I actually don't believe that employers don't know that they're being discriminatory. I think the statistics speak for themselves. I think to live in this day and age and not realise that none of your workforce is representative of the communities that you serve is hugely naive, to say the least. I think there needs to be an absolute acknowledgement within an organisation that discrimination exists, because too many people don't want to acknowledge it, so they'll put in initiatives. But those initiatives won't work because you've not dealt with the core issue. So therefore, there needs to be that acknowledgement within organisations that, yes, we understand that there is this institutional discrimination within our organisation. You then need to start looking at how you tackle that from the top down, because unless you get the buy-in from every level, be it middle management, because I've heard people say, well, the trouble is the middle managers. No, it's the front line. No, it's the strategic direction. Actually, it's all of it. And it needs to be fed through the entire organisation. And then you may see some change happening. And I don't think we've seen that yet, to the extent that we should have done by now.
Okay.
A very senior public servant very recently said, institutional racism is the natural state of affairs for the public sector in Scotland. And I would totally echo that. I think until we recognise there's a problem, we can't really do anything about it. And the data really speaks for itself. So any public body looking at the data they have, and if we're talking about employment, looking at their workforce data, but also looking at their recruitment data. I mentioned the application to success rate earlier. That should ring alarm bells straight away if that imbalance of, you know, 2-to-1 is there. If I was in that organisation, I'd want to know why that is happening. And that's where the institutional racism kicks in. People just don't care about these issues. They think, well, you know, people have had a fair interview. What's the problem? There's lots of other things which, I mean, you can call them institutional racism or you can call them whatever. I'm not really interested in terminology, but there's still word of mouth recruitment going on. Certainly in modern apprenticeships, that seems to happen a fair bit. That is going to be discriminatory against people who are not in the system already. There's all the thing about interns and work placements. It's about who you know. So if you already got family in professions, you're going to get an internship much more easily than a lot of black people who don't have those families in professional jobs. I could go on and on about these things. And the issues are very clear. We know what the issues are, and they're not difficult to tackle, really. You know, let's have open recruitment for interns. Let's not pick staff's children to do the internships, for example.
Drew would like to come in on this as well, a supplementary.
Because it relates back to the question that we asked when some of the public bodies were in, you know, when I asked them about what their understanding of institutional racism was and how they thought it related in their organisation. And I remember, convener, we got silence from them because no one wanted to use that term about the public sector, and there was a real nervousness about it, and they did, you know, they weren't much more interested in talking about unconscious bias. So there's quite a big disconnect here, and I think you've given really important evidence today. I suppose just to get something further, I'd like to know, what is the trend here? Do you feel that unconscious bias and this sort of focus is limiting your ability to overcome the real barriers as you see them that exist? Or is it all part of a spectrum that, you know, any effort to move things along is welcome? And
can I also say we've got another two sets of questions that we've got to get in, and we want to finish for 10:40, so could I ask for you to keep your question answers to, we can go a bit longer, keep your answers short, but it's fantastic evidence that we're getting today, so keep that coming as well. Jatin.
Okay, as briefly as I can. I actually looked at some of the unconscious bias training courses, there are some online, and actually it's no different to what I was teaching in the 80s. Do not prejudge people, treat everybody equally, etc., etc. There's nothing, miraculous about unconscious bias training. Just do not be unfair is really what it is. For me, as I said earlier, it's really a delaying tactic. It means we can spend money and spend another 3 years training staff on unconscious bias, and then we'll look at what the issues are. It's a 3 or 5 year delay.
Couple of points. I am very worried about the increasing use of this term, unconscious bias, and I just think it's another way of covering up an issue. And I think my concern is that with a lot of public bodies, you know, when you talk to them about what they're doing in terms of their workforce, you know, they will point to multicultural days. They will point to the fact that you can have a culturally appropriate meal in the staff canteen, as if that absolves them of any responsibility about far more pressing issues. I also think that there's BME people, when they are employed, there's a tendency to see them in terms of working with other BME communities and so-called hard-to-reach groups. And I think what employers are failing to see is that just as employees, you know, they bring the added value of being able to work with BME communities, but actually they can work with the whole community. And I think it's about turning that on its head and saying that there are additional skills and talents that having a diverse workforce brings to you, rather than seeing, oh, we need to have a BME employee to work with BME groups.
Mm-hmm. Rami, do you want to come in?
Yeah, just so that yesterday I was at a somehow similar setting, or just discussing the role of public body similar to the NHS, and I came across similar statement about the NHS services are institutionally discriminating and all this. There is no doubt there is a slight hint of individualistic cases in this setting, but it is unfair on our public body to generalize this and to slag institutional racism. As the way I've been hearing about it, I was scared even to go outside, find myself in the middle of South Africa in the 1970s. It's not that there are issues, but the idea is how we initiate cooperative partnership with these public bodies to address issues within, rather than classify everything that we come across under institutional racism. That's a big statement. That's a big series, and it's in the eyes of the law should be answerable. So we shouldn't play so much on that, but rather identify individualistic cases where we can work with those public bodies to tackle them in a positive way, rather than just keep classifying institutional racism. It's not fair. That's not my view, by the way. View from our members across Scotland on the ground as well.
Thank you, Naira.
I take your point to some extent, Rami, and I think public sector are very scared, if you like. It is a huge word, and you know, the media in terms of institutional racism. But our role And I think as the representative sitting around here, we're not here to point fingers and say, oh, look at you, and then, you know, it's not school playground. What we're here for is to work with these organisations to tackle that issue, and we want to do it as a critical friend and work with them. But we need to be supported to do that. We also need the EHRC to come in and be supported to provide the right kind of support and guidelines for them to implement that change. This isn't just about pointing the finger and walking away. It's about saying that we are frustrated by the lack of progress within those organisations, but at the same time, we want the opportunity to work with them to do something about it.
Thank you. Annabelle, are you okay? We can move on now.
I found that immensely helpful. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. John Finney.
Morning, panel. Come this stage of proceedings, most of the questions that we have pre-prepared are answered, but I'm going to, just for the record, touch on the specific duties under the Equalities Act. And just a very straightforward question, simple replies would be good, thanks. Do you think the public sector equality duty has been adhered to? And do you think the Equality and Human Rights Commission is doing enough to ensure that it's been adhered to and that employers are taking steps to overcome barriers in employment for ethnic minorities? I know, Naira, you touched on that just with the latterly there.
I think they're being adhered to an extent. I think in some cases where there are efforts to do work, but they're not going far enough. And I think that we kind of alluded to the point that where we're seeing people, minority ethnic community members, applying for posts, they're getting the interviews, so they've made the essential criteria, but they're not being appointed. And that once they get through that appointment stage, we have no information or data to understand why that is. We have no information or data to understand where people are being in employment, where they sit within that organisation. Are they at the first grade level? Are they in senior management? Where are they? So I think they're partially being met. I think there needs to be more needs to happen for them to be fully met. I think the EHRC can play a role, and they have played a role, but I think they need more powers to go in and enforce some of the changes that need to be... Sorry, I'm losing my words now. They need to be able to enforce the changes that are required, because I think there is a level of complacency, which I think my colleague mentioned, that if we've done a little bit and it's okay, then that's enough, because nobody's going to come knocking on our door and check.
The HSC have just done a review of the April 2015 publications on employment data from public bodies under the PSCD. And just by one example, in relation to staff recruitment, only 64% of the public bodies mentioned reporting on race. So they're not adhering to what the duties say. And these duties are not new. Public bodies have had a duty since 2002 to do staff monitoring and reporting. So, you know, 13 years on, if we're still only at sort of two-thirds, and this is just publication. The other thing in terms of PSCD, there is a duty on public bodies to use the data, and that's the crucial bit, as we said earlier. It's not just about collecting. And I've seen very few examples of any public body that says how it will use the data it has collected. That really is about looking at the imbalances and what is our action plan. So I would actually want the government to go back and reword those duties to make public bodies have an action plan rather than just use the data.
I know there are sort of differing opinions and degrees around data collection, but I do think it is really, really important. And at the moment, we have significant data gaps, and we really do need to focus energy on addressing those gaps so we have that evidence base, both as a baseline and a measure against progress. And I would also agree with my two colleagues that the issue really is about what people do with that data, you know, and there needs to be support given to public bodies to use it effectively.
Mm-hmm. Again, I think I reiterated earlier, there is no doubt, and I agree with my colleagues, that the public sector equality, they are not being adhered to and they are not being taken seriously. Maybe this is why we're sitting and discussing underrepresentation in employment for sitting within the public body setting. In terms of the EHRC, they've always been keen to engage even us in reporting on certain public bodies, but they can't just jump to investigate something out of the blue. They need some data beforehand. And we feel that the HRC have been overstretched, and with the cut in resources and all this, it's not fair on them. But we do value their role in monitoring the public authorities.
Okay, thank you.
Just following on from that, but the EHRC is the regulating body for these things, and unfortunately they are not keen on doing any enforcement action, in my opinion. So they publish these reports and they sort of work with bodies. I think if they took some enforcement action, it would get changed overnight.
Okay, thank you.
John?
Yeah, thank you, convener. I think we've largely covered that area. I wondered if I could address a specific point to Jatin, please, and that... The convener will conclude the business by asking about ways ahead. So, if you wouldn't comment in these terms, please. But I noted in what you said that you said you're keen that we don't replicate previous recommendations. Rather, and I hope this is the right quote that I've noted here, examine why previous efforts have failed. So, with regard to how we are conducting this, and as I stress, the future is something that the convener will conclude with. Are we going about this the right way? Because people have said, I'm being blunt, and please be assured, we appreciate you being blunt, and like you, we have significant frustrations about this. So are we going about it right?
At the risk of being
no, well,
really
please,
blunt.
You certainly won't offend me, but we want to know.
I think, having heard the evidence given by public bodies at the last session and previously, there is this culture of... complacency, if I want for a better word. There's no real urgency to take action from public bodies that I can see. And you know, the answers on how the public sector equality duties have been or not been implemented is part of that. So the problem is just a general frustration. We've been here before. There's been numerous recommendations on race and employment. I was involved in the Race Equality Advisory Forum in the old Scottish Executive in 2001 that had a whole chapter on race and employment. We've had the Strategic Labour Market Group that Scottish Government set up back in, I think, 2005, that had intense meetings and came up with an action plan and had a bold statement of eliminating the ethnic penalty by 2013. But as far as I know, nothing really happened. So the issue is, if you make recommendations, how will we get anybody to implement them? So, A, yes, there'll have to be smart recommendations so we can actually measure whether they've achieved anything or not in due course. But who's going to measure that? Who's going to monitor? So, at the very least, you should commit to I know you can't commit future committees, but in 5 years' time, you should look at your recommendations and see whether anybody actually did, you know, paid a blind bit of attention to them.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Kamina.
Thank you very much. anybody else want to briefly comment? We move on. Okay, Drew.
Thanks, convener. Maybe just going, I suppose there's a couple of questions I wanted to ask that really around positive action, maybe beyond the public sector equality duty. And I know that, Naira, in your submission, you talked about you know, positive action sometimes getting mixed up with good practice. And I think that's partly maybe what Suzanne was alluding to as well with the example that she used. So we'll come on to that. But could I maybe just first of all ask you what you think, in terms of positive action being distinct from the duty or good practice, what are the limits at the moment on people using positive action? And if it's helpful to go, you know, to then take that to, and what can we do to change it? Just a response to that.
I think positive action has a role, but I think it's kind of limited in what it can do. Mm-hmm. I don't think it should be used in every situation or every, you know, organisation or public sector should have that, because for me, the bigger picture is how do we actually make changes where we don't require positive action? It's a short-term measure. We've talked previously, my colleague mentioned the Positive Action Training Housing Programme, but I would be really interested to understand what impact has that had in the long term. Are we training graduates to sit in frontline posts? Are we training graduates to actually become managers? Where have they gone as a result of a positive action measure? I don't actually know of many organisations that have taken up this route, and I think there is a concern about how that would be viewed within the wider workforce, because today, even today, with all the terminology in the world, positive action is still referred to as positive discrimination, which it's not. If they haven't got a clear understanding of the equalities legislation of race equality within an organisation, then they will not understand how this positive action programme would fit within their organisation. I think there is a real kind of energy now to try and not just look at mainstreaming, but also look at what other measures that we can do to combat the inequalities. So I would take positive action, but as a short-term measure to make a long-term impact in terms of mainstreaming equalities.
I think the theme of positive action has been going on for a long time, and BMIS, we've been very proactive in deploying this scheme in Scotland and in advancing things forward. However, if I can make a comment explanation symbolically about the difference between positive action and positive discrimination, because there's lots of confusion among stakeholders and the communities regarding this. The way I always explain it is, if we have a racing line where people are expected to run for a race, we can't expect ethnic minorities to be given half a mile ahead of everybody else. That's positive discrimination and will be rejected by the minorities. Anybody is unethical, illegal, and not tolerated in the UK and by the minorities. However, equally, it's not feasible to allow ethnic minorities to start half a mile behind the line. That is where we have to start working on those minorities through advice on their fitness, on their dietary thing, to enable them to be on the same line, and whoever wins the race after that. That's symbolically. When we deal with stakeholders, they are still scared of the whole concept of positive action, and they do think it's a preferential treatment for minorities, which is not. Positive action, again, is understood by certain public bodies on the basis is, for example, if there is a cultural event for the minority, they go and have a stall there. They think that's it. It's more, should be more focused than this setting. Some of the positive action scheme, for example, the government introduced the internship, a graduate internship program. That was initially was supposed to be for ethnic minority, was supposed to be meant as a positive action scheme, but it was against the law because it involves employment payments. So we have to advise the government, say, no, this is against the law. It can't go as a positive action scheme. So it's been referred within a wider equality setting. That worked very well, where both CEMVO and BMIS managed to get lots of graduates to progress into employment in the field. However, that was temporary, and it was cut off or referred to another third organization, which is SCVO, to run things for us, while those graduates would have trusted us and CEMVO to enable them and empower them to have the confidence to progress in this setting. But the concept of positive action is valid, is feasible. Academic institutions love it to work with us on it, and it should sustain an interest in any strategy in the future. But positive discrimination, I think I'm speaking on behalf of BMIS and our members, no way we will tolerate it, because that's insulting for the minorities.
I totally disagree with that last comment. I can't let it stand. You know, we're on other issues, on gender certainly, we've gone to the line where we allow positive discrimination in political parties, and we're now looking at 50-50 on boards, which will be some measure of positive discrimination. We're talking about levelling the playing field as a short-term measure. So positive discrimination, if that's what it takes, that's what we need. I know that's not under our control in terms of legislation. But on positive action, unfortunately, most of the initiatives are about addressing what CEMVO and we have called the deficit model. Something wrong with black people before they apply, we need to do something to equip them. Now, certainly for some people, that's true. But for the vast majority, as Naira said very early on, you know, black minority people, especially young people, are better qualified than their white counterparts, et cetera, et cetera. So something else is going on. Where it could have been used, I mean, you know, when the police were recruiting 1,000 extra police officers a few years back, what did they do? They had a golden opportunity there to get 100 extra black police officers if they wanted to. I'm not sure they did anything specifically in that recruitment round. And that would have been a golden opportunity when you've got such a big recruitment exercise going on to do something. And we know all about the underrepresentation in the police.
Can John Mason come in
on this? Yes, I've got this point for me. And kind of really to follow up what Rami just said, because I mean, it seems to me, to take your track analogy, I mean, yes, we can get people as fit as they can and healthy and all the rest of it, but if part of the track is harder to run on, and it appears that the part of the track given to black and ethnic minority folk is harder to run on, then surely they do need an advantage, because they're going to have to put in more effort to get to the end of the line.
The whole idea of positive action is it doesn't apply only for ethnic minority, it applies, for example, for single mothers. Okay, so the idea is to overcome disadvantages that historically you've been placed, and to enable you to be like anybody else in terms of competing. Try to say this, for example, to John or Jason from Drum Chapel when you say we want positive discrimination, for example. That would create tension and would create a lot of inequality in the setting of...
But how do you answer the point that it's been done for women? Because that was the only way we could get women into the cabinet. It was to say it's 50%. Shouldn't we be doing the same?
50% is... No, 50%, suppose, and with all respect to all the cabinet, is the idea just to get people because of their ethnicity? Like, for example, am I allowed to be given a job, even if I'm an idiot, I don't fulfill that job just because I'm an ethnic minority? Is that the way forward in terms of positive discrimination? In terms of empowering women to fit on boards and through good practice, through encouragement, through identifying skills, yes, that's excellent. Actually, on our board, this has been well before any initiative was brought in by the government. We were in 60-40 even. But the idea is we're against granting, advantages just because of your ethnicity. Because even most, not only me, most of minority people have pride and have dignity and they want to achieve things through their own abilities. And as I said, like socioeconomic things, poverty, all this doesn't affect only ethnic minorities, especially employment. But I'm sharing this in based on our experience talking to people. As I said, if I go back to the question of Jean from Drum Chapel or Postal Park, to know that ethnic minority can be given advantage by getting employment because of their ethnicity, but for them, on their socioeconomic, no, it's not right. Ethically, it's not right even. Sorry.
I'm really hesitating not to respond with my own view to that. But what we're trying to deal with is our structural inequalities. Would you not accept that you would require structural interventions to deal with that? And yeah, you can always find examples of individuals and think, well, why are they in that job? But that's the case at the moment, and that's not those instances are not reflective of a structural inequality where you've got a significant disconnect between the representation of a group of people in society versus the representation in management positions or in government or the public sector or employment more generally or whatever.
Back to this context, if you reflect the story, and I'm speaking as an ethnic minority and I'm proud of my citizenship and ethnicity, but when you get various ethnic minority groups stating, for example, that I'm not dark enough to be serving in an ethnic minority organization, that gives you a reflection of where the ethnicity classification stage has reached. Or if we stand to empower the minorities to let them progress themselves in this society with pride and dignity while supporting them to build their skills, their this to progress on, that is something should be viewed as negative. No, the way forward is to work with our minority communities, with the stakeholders, build the bridges between them and empower them to progress. Otherwise, we'll end up for the next 2 years talking about disadvantaged minorities, poor souls, creating a culture of dependency. We want to create a culture of citizenship and power moving forward. This, the stage of removing barriers, as Mr. Mason said, yes, he's right. Why should there be different rules for different people? That's the idea where we talk about race equality setting beyond the symbolic meaning of positive action. But for us, it's about empowerment, removing existing barriers in a positive way. It doesn't have to be always by attacking and undermining. And we have to create structures for our communities to start believing in their abilities to function as equal citizens in Scotland.
Okay. As an ethnic minority and a woman, I'm very happy about the 50-50 rule. But I just wanted to say that the whole point of positive action and the reason that it exists is because it's addressing the inequalities that already exist. It's not that positive action is creating those inequalities. So I just wanted to make that point.
Suzanne, briefly.
I think positive action does have a place, but when you look at it in the wider context, so for example, going back to BME younger people who have higher levels of educational attainment when they leave school but are not reflected in the job market, positive action isn't necessarily going to address that issue. When you have, you know, such a disparity in terms of people applying and being appointed within public sector bodies, they meet the essential criteria. They're getting shortlisted. They're not getting appointed. Positive action isn't necessarily going to address that issue. So I think whilst it has a place, there are much more embedded, entrenched structural issues that we need to examine. And I think it's time to have an honest and difficult conversation. I think we have to be brave.
It's okay then. I suppose what I mean there is some agreement. Just sticking to the positive action bit, that's, and the positive discrimination bit is separate. But there was quite a broad agreement that there is a place for it. But there probably isn't really an awareness about what would fit into that category and how well it's used. Is there anything that can be done to champion an explanation of what is a positive action as opposed to a debate about positive discrimination or something else? And how is there anyone who's charged with that of rolling that out across different kinds of bodies and sharing that learning?
Before you actually start, can I say we really need very brief answers now because we are seriously running out of time. Suzanne? Do you want to answer?
Gosh, no, I think Rami. I'm thinking.
Right, you're thinking, right, I'll give you time.
Yeah, sorry, it's just in terms of positive action, we have a partnership arrangement with the Scottish FA to improve participation of minority in sport, in football sport. That's not to play football, they play anyway. It's just to progress them within the becoming football coaches and referees and within mainstream football clubs. An outcome of that setting is to facilitate participation of minority women, which at the beginning we thought it would be a very hard issue to engage. However, we have developed more than 60, 65 ethnic minority female coaches now. This has been allowed by enabling participation setting in a female-only facilities in settings where now they are more confident to go and extend this or cascade this training to their local communities.
Jatin, briefly, please.
Answer Drew's question directly. I don't know of any systematic interventions on or sort of training or advice on positive action. Maybe instead of spending all this money on unconscious bias training, public sector could do something about equipping their staff about positive action. I would go a little bit further, maybe in terms of, we spoke earlier about the public sector equality duty, there's the duty to use the employee information. Let's put in a duty for all public sector bodies to report on what positive action measures they have taken so they can be very explicit and they can tell us what they're doing.
Okay. Naira, do you want to comment?
I think I would agree with what Jatin's saying there in terms of there are already guidelines. There are already, the EHRC have produced papers to say what positive action means and how people can apply that. There is not a direct requirement for them to do it. They're encouraged to do, to use positive action. But I think, yes, if the public bodies have reported that they are making headway, then come and tell us about what they're doing.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thanks, Drew. Thank you very much. The committee is actually hoping to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Communities and Pensioners' Rights towards the end of our evidence gathering. It would be quite useful if you could tell us what issues you suggest we actually raise with them, if you want to give us some just now, or do you want to take time and think about it and send us it in writing? Suzanne?
A lot of the discussion today has focused on BME youth employment, unemployment, and I think that is a hugely important issue. But there are other people in the BME workforce, and I'm thinking of people in their middle years, and I'm not going to put a number on that because that's apparently fluid, but actually, that there are quite a significant cohort within the BME communities in their middle years who have worked for a long time in very hard occupations, and when we look at the census, we're talking about retail, wholesale, hospitality, service industries, and I think that they're at an age now when life circumstances are going to be increasingly impacting on them. So, for example, poorer health, perhaps caring responsibilities, and the general downturn in the economy. And I would not like that cohort to be ignored within the debate. Research that we carried out for one of the legacy commissions with this particular age group, they came back with saying that if they were ill, if they were caring for somebody, if there were family issues, they would hide it for their employer because they were afraid of losing their job and then being able to get back into the employment market. And particularly when the employment market, in terms of skills, is moving on quickly, again, there is perhaps an issue to look at skills and developing skills within this age cohort.
Thank you. Jatin.
We will write to you to give you stuff to ask the Cabinet Secretary, but obviously in terms of Scottish Government itself, you know, they have a 20% non-disclosure of their workforce. So you could ask him what the plans are about that. And then, as we just said about previous recommendations, you know, the Scottish Government set up this strategic labour market group on race and employment 10 years ago or something. What happened to that? And that might help you make sure you don't repeat the same recommendations or at least do something slightly differently.
Naira. About the regulation bodies and look at what are they doing in terms of looking at the equalities work that are required of public sector organisations. I think there needs to be a little bit more, you know, looking at themselves as a regulatory body and how comfortable they are around asking some of the equality questions and looking at intersectionality as well.
Thank you. Rami?
I think an area which we're interested in is to ensure that the government or the cabinet secretary is aware of the role of the third sector in progressing and assisting the government in fulfilling its policies or strategy. So whatever happens in relation to employment, we don't want to see it as if it's the responsibility of the government only, but it's the responsibility of groups like us in terms of accountability and responsibility, but with the support of the Scottish Government.
Thank you very much. Okay. John, very, very briefly.
Jatin mentions a task force as one of the suggestions. What would a task force do that no present body is doing?
It would do all this work that we say, look at previous recommendations, examine why they didn't work, examine what really needs to work, go and drill down with these authorities to find out are they actively looking at why the imbalance between application and success at interview is there. It would be a sort of medium-term monitoring body that will make sure recommendations get implemented.
Is that partly because ECHR is not doing their job?
Partly.
Okay, thank you.
John Finney, very briefly.
No, my question was on exactly the same.
Very briefly answer.
But again, picking up on that question, I think perhaps one of the issues that the task force, that the proposed task force could look at, were also other mechanisms. So, for example, in terms of economic development grant aid, whether we could look at having a social responsibility clause within that.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Naira, very, very briefly.
The task force would be able to drill down to some of the key issues around where are people going where they don't have access to the employment pathways. For example, one of the areas of work that we're doing is supporting ethnic minority community to set up social enterprises, which is great in itself, but the route into social enterprise is because there are no other route into other forms of employment. So I think there needs to be a little bit more done to understand where the labour market is and what the alternatives are.
Thank you. Rami, very briefly.
Sorry, quickly. Okay.
If possible, Rami, please.
I think the whole concept of the task force could carry the risk of becoming another a group that keep on meeting and discussing the same things over and over again. So unless we know what authority would such task force have or what role would the government authorise for this, it will turn up into another debating or tokenistic session.
Thank you very much. Thanks very much. This has been an excellent evidence session this morning. Thank you all very, very much for coming forth and giving us this information. Some of the main points we've actually heard is things like collecting data, making sure developments are issue-led, linking to stakeholders, a rejection of the use of the term unconscious bias, institutional discrimination and the role of the EHRC. If there's anything else you want to actually submit you have not had the opportunity to actually say in this very tight session, please actually send us some written information. Thank you all very much for coming along. We've really enjoyed it this morning. And that actually concludes the public part of today's meeting. We will hear informally from businesses on the 29th of October. And I'll now suspend the meeting for the committee to move into private session. And thank you all very much again. Thank you.